Will you please stand? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Your love, O God, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies.
Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the great deep.
Earth children, high and low, take refuge in the shadow of your wings.
We feast on the abundance of your house. You give us drink from your river of delights.
For with you is the fountain of life, in your light we see light.
Glory be to you.
Let us worship God together.
Bless our day.
God, who is not indifferent to human suffering, but is with us in the messiness of our lives, sent Jesus to love and care for us. We are also sent into the world to love and care for others. Let us confess our need for God and hear God's calling. Sometimes, O God, your word is too much for us. You ask us to love our enemies when we can scarcely love our friends as we should. You ask us to give when we want to take, and to forgive when we want to nurse bitterness. We thank you that you accept us as we are, and that you show us what we can be. Help us to believe that we can be loving and just like you. Through the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
We have seen the light. We have heard the call. We will dance in the light with our God.
Let us pray. Living God, with joy we celebrate the presence of your risen word. Enliven our hearts by your Holy Spirit, so that we may proclaim the good news of eternal and abundant life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. A reading from Isaiah. But there will be no gloom for those who are in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the later time, he will make the glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. We have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppression, you have broken as on the day of Midian. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter to the Corinthians. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you should be in agreement, and that there should be no divisions among you, but that you should be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is, each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee
the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near." And as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And as he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. And he called them immediately, and they left the boat, their father, and followed him. Now Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Of death. What's my sermon title? It says, "Those who have sat in the shadow of death have," what is it? What has come? The light has dawned. So, obviously, the Gospel of St. John interprets Isaiah chapter 4 message about the light that has come for those who sat in darkness, those who are exiled and were suffering. And he reinterprets that text to mean the light has come in whom? Jesus Christ. And so the question then is, what then does it mean for us to follow this light? It is of one's question, identity and vocation, right? Which I will not get too heavily into because, as some of you may know, my good spiritual friend and mentor is here, Charles Yu, Reverend Pastor Charles Yu. He's sitting in the back. And this is a part one, and part two will be this afternoon at 4. The reason is that we've been exchanging notes. As soon as he arrived, we have been having a very, very fascinating and interesting and very important conversation about Christian identity and vocation. And also stimulated by my sons here, Joshua and Alex, and our friend here, Tara's here as well. And so we are really, I had a wonderful time because I haven't seen my kids in a while. And it helps me understand the next generation and their understanding of faith. You know, their pastor's kid are very critical, as I was to my father, and they're critical of me. And so we also had a very stimulating conversation around this idea of Christian identity and vocation. And it's very interesting that this wedding we're going to have this afternoon, because with me and you are now going to be joined together in a covenant relationship as partner in ministry into the future, right? So in a way, it is, quote, unquote, a marriage between us. It's a great celebration, and I'm getting some cold feet right now. So, are you all ready for this afternoon?
Yes.
I just want to say heartfelt gratitude to say thank you. Thank you so much. I know it's been a very, very busy week, and the choir especially. The choir has to rehearse a lot this week. Drew's like, not really. I know you have to put a lot of hours into this, and we have guests coming this afternoon at 4. It is the role of the presbytery to officiate and conduct this wedding, but it seems like it really largely fell on our laps, and we have to make this happen, right? But it's okay. That's the way it works, and I think we are fully prepared, and that is why we will have reception next door rather than in the cool fellowship hall. So going back to the message. The gospel lesson today says, those who have sat in the region and the shadow of death, light has dawned. And from that time, Jesus began to proclaim, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. And then he calls his first disciples, right? So he begins his ministry, and here we are. I don't think it was by accident that this installation service we're going to have took place in this timely fashion, right? I think God had designed this together so that we will be more intentional about what we are actually getting into, the kind of a partnership in ministry that we're getting into. Jesus called his disciples. Jesus is calling you and I in covenant relationship into a ministry. What does it mean for us then to be a follower of Christ? What is this whole idea of a light that has come and that it has dawned in the shadow of death that people are living in? It is a big question, is it not? It is a big question. And the conversation I had, I think that we have heard here in my family was, you know, when you talk about justice and righteousness, it's too abstract, Dad, right? It's too abstract. Let's bring it down to something very concrete. And the conversation really came down to this much more easily understandable, is that in the people who are living under the shadow of death are experiencing what? What are they experiencing if you're under the shadow of death? If you're exiled and you're not home and you are displaced, what are you going through? There's one word. Can you describe it? Suffering. You're in pain. Human suffering is everywhere. It's another way to describe the word injustice, right? When you've been forcefully removed from a place, it's injustice. There is a real structural injustice that we're living in. We call it racism, classism, sexism, no matter what you want to name it. There are multiple sites of institutionalized system in which we not only participate in, and every one of us are guilty of that, right? No matter how much we say we're not part of or cause of human suffering, we are. We're consumers. We're participating in our capitalist system. There's no way of getting around it. So we are participants of a cause of our human suffering. Yes, given that, there's suffering everywhere. And the word I have, and the word in which our scripture names it, that's why we have to do what? We come here Sunday morning after morning, and what do we do? First thing in the order of worship. As Jesus says, repent. Right? Repent. For the kingdom of God is near. So Christian identity is to recognize and accept the reality that we are not only participants of our human suffering, but that we are also a cause, and that we ourselves are also victims, and we also suffer as well. In the time of Jesus, when he was baptized and he was immediately led into the wilderness, and as he began to call his first disciples, what is the historic context by which he was spreading this good news of the gospel, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand? It's in the context of Roman Empire. People were removed and dislocated. They were enslaved. There was slavery. Women were not even considered a citizen. They're part of a property, right? I don't think you want to live in that world. The average life expectancy was 30 years. But the sad thing is those realities, those same structures that would hold and uphold and support the empire, is the same structure, the same evil that is currently active today. Is it not? So in some sense, the context in which this gospel is preached is no different than then and now. And you and I are James and John in that place being called by Jesus in response within the context of human suffering and misery and injustice and oppression. And Jesus is saying, come, follow me. For you are casting your net and catching fish now, but you follow me and I will make you a fisher of men and women, people. Let's use inclusive language here. So that's what Jesus did. He called his first disciples. That calling. What is our calling? What is God calling us into in this midst of human suffering that we see everywhere? People displaced, millions of people who are displaced because of war and violence, children who are suffering from hunger. 50 million Americans officially under the extreme poverty right now. And only $50 billion a year could actually solve some of those problems in which we can't even allocate our money into. These are some of the solvable. But again, the question is this. Not should we only be charitable to those who are suffering, but to ask the question of why are there suffering and we need to become an advocate for justice, right? To alleviate the human suffering. To resist and continue to understand our participation and our location and our place in this context. That God had called each and every one of us, recognizing that we are created in the image of the divine, that we are created in the image of God. Light has dawned. Those who were exiled in the time of Isaiah, displaced and are suffering, wanted to return home. And the good news that Prophet Isaiah proclaimed was that you could return home. Light has come. You don't have to suffer unnecessarily anymore. And John the Baptist also likewise recognized Jesus, right? And Matthew said, a light has come, and names Jesus as the light of the world, and those who follow and accept Jesus to follow in that footstep, to repent of our participation in the evil, in our baptismal covenant. What is the first thing we do, which we are going to also recite at the 4 o'clock service as we discern our own vocation? What do we do in our baptismal covenant? We reject what? Renounce of this world and the values of this world, right? To be a disciple, to be a follower, is to reject the system that is in place that causes human suffering. And we call it sin. We call it evil. So here it is. Jesus is calling us, the first disciples, James and John, the kingdom of heaven is near. And so what are the signs of this kingdom of God that has dawned upon us? The reality of God's truth, the reality of God's heart for our humanity has come in the form of embodiment of the ministry of Jesus and his identity as a child of God, as one who is beloved. Okay. How does that take form and shape in that ministry which we also have been called to participate? Verse 23, what does it say? For Jesus went throughout Galilee teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news for the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The ministry of Jesus Christ is defined simply by this: alleviating human suffering, healing those who are suffering, those who are wounded, and who are profoundly experiencing oppression in the context of those empire and society that has sustained those things. So, this is a tall order, right? Tall order. Just to bring it back home, we also experience our own personal suffering. We have our own demons that we wrestle with and we struggle with. And we see that. And sometimes what is happening in our lives and what is happening in our world doesn't help at all. And if we're going to be helpful as a faith community at all, as a follower of Christ who leads us into the healing ministry and reconciliation and building peace to alleviate human suffering, who are we as people of God, and what is our calling in our place in our own lives and in this world? You know, one of the ways to elevate in the last closing remark is this. How do you help someone when someone is suffering? You point out the suffering. Oh my goodness, you're suffering. That doesn't help, right? To be empathetic. To be present in the midst of suffering. To say, I got you. I hold your hand, right? And it helps when I'm suffering by myself that someone is with me. Someone is holding my hand. It helps that I am not alone, that we are here together, that our faith draws us together. that we are not alone. That helps, right? Second, what else helps in our human suffering? That my suffering is not random accident. That it doesn't happen because, you know. And it feels like it. But even when you're going through difficulty and hardship, that there is a meaning here. When you understand that there is a purpose, not that suffering in itself has a purpose and meaning, but that in spite of the suffering and because of suffering, that we are able to move forward into the future because we find something that is meaningful. Does that make sense? I mean, think about Jesus' suffering. Here we have the cross, the very symbol of human suffering. Scapegoated, martyred. All the causes of human suffering we talk about, this mechanism has hammered Jesus on the cross, right? But God has turned our human suffering into what? A power of hope and resurrection. That's the good news. That is the good news. That is the light that has dawned upon us. So as we hold hands together this afternoon in our marriage, in our covenant, into the future, we don't know what holds and what future lies. But what we do know is that no matter what challenges that we may face, I got you and you got me, right? We hold our hands. And know that you and I have been entrusted with the gospel, the good news of love of God. That you and I are called to follow Christ to alleviate human suffering into the ministry of healing and ministry of reconciliation and peace. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Will you please rise? Let us confess the faith of the universal truth.
The Father, the
Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again,
in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come
again in glory to judge
the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. Proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
We acknowledge one
baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the
resurrection of the dead
and the life
of the world to come. Amen.
At this time, I would like to invite you to share joys or concerns for intercessional prayer. Are there anyone who would like to share at this time? Yes, Matt.
I ask prayers for Vicki Espinosa. She was one of the caregivers for my parents, Betsy's parents, in their final years of life. She was involved in a very serious automobile accident. Oh. Hospitalized for 3 weeks
now. Vicky, I'm sorry. Okay. So prayer for Vicky, who is hospitalized and is suffering. Yes. So prayer for Alyssa.
Laura.
Prayer for Laura. Okay. Yes.
Just thank you for the prayers. Thank God that Maren made it through the surgery. I'm grateful for the prayers that you all have given to us for Maren. And just continue praying that her heart will mend as she endures these next few weeks of having a past and understanding that God is working for good.
Yes. She is suffering, poor thing. She broke her arm the last year, and now the second one here. And so, okay, prayer for Maren. Okay.
All right.
Okay. Prayer for, continue prayer. Any other joys or concerns we would like to share at this time? Yes?
It's a great joy to be among you again after my time away and my need recuperating.
Thank you.
It's good to be here.
Good to see you again here. Any other joys or concerns? Yes? Sarah? Okay, great. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks that we are able to come together as a faith community to offer and share our joys and our concerns and to pray on behalf of those especially suffering in our midst. We pray for Vicky, who had an accident and is recovering in hospital. Give her the strength she needs today. And also Maren, who had a broken arm, and mend her heart and as well as her body. Give her the strength and comfort she needs this day. We pray for family of Lauren, who is going through a lot of suffering. May your peace and your comfort abide with them. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, as we remember the beginning of the ministry of Jesus Christ, of his healing ministry, and the prophetic vision of return home for those who are exiled, we also recall and remember those who are displaced in our world. We pray for people of Ukraine in this terrible proxy war that people are suffering so much. We pray for your peace. We pray for violence to cease, that you will give wisdom to the leadership of those who are involved and the governments, that they may be peace sooner than later. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for our country. We pray for our government. We pray for people who are in places of making decisions, who exercise power, that you will give them wisdom and that you will give a compassion to the hearts and minds of those who are leading, that we care for those who are most needed in our society, in our community. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our prayer. Lord, we pray for our church, our congregation, as we step forward and understanding who we are as followers of Christ, knowing that you have called us together and binding us together in partnership and ministry. As we celebrate our union and our partnership, called to the ministry of Christ this afternoon, help us and empower us with your Holy Spirit. Bless each and every one of us here today. that we all have a share and part in the ministry of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Knowing that we're blessed with your Spirit, we pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today your daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Will you please stand? The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us turn to one another with the peace of Christ. Peace, shalom. Shalom, peace be with you. Peace, sir. Seeing you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Okay, we did. Peace be with you. Linda, peace be with you. Okay. Peace. Okay, so I'm gonna have to.
For from whom all my blessings flow.
Jesus sat around with his disciples to have his Passover meal, as we understand it today as the Lord's Last Supper. And in that context of the Passover, remembering the historic act of God's redemption in history, those who are in the bondage of slavery, God has led them into a wilderness, into the promised land. As they remember and recall in that liberating and redeeming memory, they gather around having their Passover meal while the Roman soldiers around the city are watching and guarding them. So he invited them, those who hunger and thirst for human freedom, those who are suffering, those who are in their midst of pain and hunger, come. Wherever you are, whoever you are, take, eat this bread, drink this cup, and do this in remembrance of me. Remembrance of Christ, who calls us to the very ministry. The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Indeed, it is our greatest right and joy to give thanks to the Lord our God for the meal that has been provided for us, that the healing ministry and partnership that we are engaged is not an abstraction, but it is concrete as the bread and the wine we take that nourishes our body, not only in a real physical reality, but also as a metaphorical a spiritual truth that God has given us around this table by which we are called to live our lives in such a way that alleviate from human suffering and its sins. So let us sing together the Sanctus.
Holy, Lord, God of heart and mind.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed be the Lord in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
God of compassion and mercy, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and the wine we are to take. We thank you and we give you thanks and praise for all that you do in our lives. In Christ's name, amen.
My name. Now my boat's left on the shoreline behind me. By your side, I will seek other seas.
Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, he took the bread and he gave thanks to God and he broke it and he said, "This is my bread, this is my body broken for you. Take, eat. And do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup, the chalice, and he poured the wine. And he turned to his disciples and he said, "This is my blood shed for you. Take, drink this cup, share in this cup, and do this in remembrance of me." The bread and the wine is ready. Let us come and partake of these elements. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Christ broken for you? Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you, Joshua. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you, Jesus. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you.
Thanks be to God.
Body of Christ broken. Body of Christ broken for you.
Thanks be to God.
Body of Christ. Body of Christ. Body of Christ broken for you.
Amen.
Elizabeth, body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Sammy, body of Christ broken for you.
Thanks be to God.
Body of Christ broken for you.
Salvation. Amen. Eat this bread, drink this cup,
Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for the wine and the bread, these elements that have nourished our body, and as also a memory and remembrance of the ministry of Jesus Christ, that each and every one of us this day have been called to serve in the ministry of healing and reconciliation of this world, for peacemaking and for justice making. We're grateful that we're not alone, but that we are together as a faith community empowered by your Holy Spirit. So with gratitude and with thanksgiving, we pray in the name of Jesus. And all people of God said, Amen. 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 So, once again, we're going to clap our hands. We are marching in the light of God. 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 We are marching, we are marching. We are marching in the light of God. We are marching, we are marching, oh, we are marching. Okay, now, we are dancing, here we go. We are dancing in the light of God. 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 We are dancing. We are dancing, oh, we are dancing in the light of God. We are dancing, we are dancing, oh, we are dancing in the light of God. We are praying, we are praying in the light of God. 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 We are praying, we are praying. We are praying in the light of God. We are praying, we are praying. We are praying in the light of God. We are singing now. We are singing in the light of God. 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 We are singing, we are singing, oh, singing in the light of God. We are singing, we are singing, oh, we are singing in the light of God. We are singing. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Wow, you guys speaking 2-3 languages? This is incredible. Again, just a reminder that this afternoon at 4, we have a big event. It's not just my own personal act. Again, it is a communal installation. It is a wedding. It is a partnership. And the presbytery and the entourage of clergy members will be here. And my good spiritual friend and mentor, Charles, will be preaching the second part of the sermon. The sequel, as he says. So he's not fully defined the sermon yet, but he says he has to hear it first. So he's still in his development. So I'm looking forward to it. And he has been part of my ministry for over 20 plus years, have watched me over the years. And so I'm so grateful that he is here, able to preach and preside part of the participants. So, may the Spirit of God, that empowered Jesus, that has blessed Jesus, that has led and gave him the strength he needs to do the ministry of God, may that same Spirit be with each and every one of us, so that we may move not only as individuals, but as a community of faith in the call which God has called us, the ministry of Christ, of healing, alleviating from human suffering, unnecessary human suffering, to bring justice, to bring hope, to bring light for those who are seated in the dark corners of our world. And now may the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the communion and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit be with us all. And all God's people said, Amen.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.